We are talking about artificial life and nature-inspired algorithms. In particular, we are now talking about evolutionary algorithms. We have already learned about quite a few general optimization algorithms. Now we are talking about evolutionary algorithms, in particular genetic algorithms. And last time we discussed two architectures of evolutionary algorithms, in particular genetic ones. We talked about steady state and generational architecture. We also learned how the main loop of a genetic algorithm looks like. And now it's time to focus on this selection process as the key process which lets you select some individuals and reproduce, which means make many copies of some good solutions, whereas you ignore or you forget about poor solutions. You do not want poor solutions to be reproduced. From the reproduction stage, we expect good individuals to be multiplied. The stronger the dominance of better solutions over worse ones, higher selective pressure. You can define pressure as, for example, the ratio of probability of reproducing the best individual over the average individual, for example. The stronger the dominance of better over worse, the lower the diversity of the resulting population will be. This is interesting. So the stronger you promote the better ones, the lower the diversity. So you lose diversity when you promote best individuals. Okay, you would also lose diversity if you promoted worst individuals. So this is just the question of over-reproducing some individuals. But since you have a fixed size of the population, when you make more copies of something, at the same time you have to remove something else. So this is how you lose diversity. These two aspects of selection, preference for better individuals over worse ones and maintaining diversity, are to a certain extent contradictory, although both are also desirable. So we want to have some diversity, because otherwise we will converge in this space of solutions to a single region, which is what we don't want, because when we converge, we lower the probability of discovering some other interesting solution or solution area in some other location in this huge space of all solutions. So this makes sense that we want to have some diversity, but at the same time, diversity comes at some cost, because if we have diverse solutions, some of them are probably good and some of them are not so good. So we maybe do not want to have some part of our population occupied by poor solutions, but we need to have them for diversity. Okay, so you see this contradiction in those two criteria or those two goals. The selective pressure is controlled, for example, by means of scaling of individual fitness values. So we may adjust this fitness function value, this original evaluation shown in this picture in red, we can somehow transform it by some other function. Like, for example, multiply by 2, or multiply by 10, or multiply by 10,000, maybe subtract something from this value. And in this way, we will be changing the proportion of those quality values of one solution over another. If we have, for example, 1 and 3, this solution is 3 times better than this one. But if we subtract half, we will have half and 2.5. And then this proportion of qualities is immediately quite different. Too high pressure will lead to premature convergence to a local optimum. Yes, if our pressure would be extremely high, then we would be reproducing, for example, only the best individual, and we would immediately lose all the diversity, right? If our population, like, for example, this is our best individual, we will make 1,000 copies of this individual and maybe mutate each of them a little bit. but still we would immediately forget about all other individuals. So we would immediately lose diversity due to extremely high selective pressure, because the best individuals at a given time will gain preponderance and dominate the remaining solutions. On the other hand, low selective pressure will ensure a high diversity of individuals in populations, which may result in the inefficiency of the entire evolutionary process and make it similar to a random search. If we didn't prefer better solutions over poor solutions at all, then we would indeed have the algorithm that behaves as if there was no selective pressure. So we would only have some mutations, some crossing over, and evaluating new individuals all the time. But their reproduction capability would be similar no matter how good they are. Yes, so it makes sense that then it would be like a random process, like randomly wandering in this huge space of solutions. Now, let's have a look at this main loop. And we have this selection process. And now it's time for you to design your own selection method and maybe even a few selection methods. A few competing selection methods. Maybe one would be better, one would be worse. Just try to be creative and suggest some algorithm, very simple algorithm, which, given a number of solutions, a number of objects with their quality. Let's assume that this quality is just a single number. Like I gave you an example of 1 and 3. So it's just a single number. The higher the number, the higher the quality. It's just the value of the fitness function, right? And you need to ensure that you get this as an argument, a list of solutions, a vector of solutions with qualities, and you need to produce the same number of solutions. Like, for example, you get 10,000, you also produce 10,000, but some of them need to have many copies. And which of them need to have many copies? Those good ones. The better the solution, the more copies it should have. And at the same time, you should preserve, or you should keep the size, the length of this vector of solutions constant. So you get 10,000, you produce 10,000. You get 100, you produce 100. Okay? Some simple algorithm, or maybe a few ideas of the algorithm. If all qualities are more or less the same, you produce more or less the same distribution of solutions. So maybe then nothing would change. If all qualities, all fitness values are the same, your algorithm should produce the same list as it got as the argument. But if there are noticeable differences in qualities, then you should produce more of those good ones and less of those bad ones. You should not pass through those bad solutions to the output of the function. You get them in your list, and they do not appear in the output of your function. So think about a few ideas of selection algorithms, and let's pause here. We will need some helpful variables for our discussion on selection techniques. Let fi be the fitness of ith individual. I changes from 1 to population size. So it's simply the index, the number of an individual. And ei is the number of its expected copies in the new population. Ei is equal to population size multiplied by the value of the fitness function and divided by the sum of all fitness functions. How to understand this formula? First of all, this seems simply like a normalized quality of a given individual. We have those indexes I, and j. And j here means over all individuals. So this sum should be from j equal 1 to pop size, to population size. So we calculate the sum of qualities of these evaluations of all individuals, and we use this ith individual fitness and divide it by this sum. So if we calculated this fraction for every individual, for ith individual, and then we would sum up all these fractions for all individuals, we would have 1, right? Because the equality of all individuals, when we sum it, sums up to this value at the denominator. So it's just like a normalization of the fitness function. But then we multiply it by population size. This EI is the number of its expected copies. So we could say that this is how many copies this individual should have in the next population if we were fair. If we were not random, but if we were fair. We will have an example calculated in a moment. The most popular selection techniques are fitness proportionate random selection with replacement. What a long name. Commonly called the roulette wheel technique. Okay, roulette wheel sounds more friendly. This is how it works. This is our entire population. We have only 4 individuals. But this area on this roulette wheel is proportional to the quality of each individual. So, for example, this individual and this one are probably 2 best individuals. This is directly scaled from the original fitness function value. So, from this red value. If this would be 3 and this would be 1, then on this wheel, this area would be 3 times larger than this area. Okay? And then we imagine that we rotate this wheel, and just as with roulette, we have a ball, and this ball will fall into some area. Of course, it will fall more often in larger areas, and this probability of ball falling into some area or some slot will be proportional to the angle or the quality of the solution which shares this slot. So we have a simple animation like this, very funny animation. In this case, since our population size is 4, we would only rotate this wheel and repeat this process 4 times. And every time a ball would fall into some slot, and this would indicate which individual we want to select. Okay? So it's a very probabilistic stochastic method, very random method. But at the same time, on average, it ensures that those better individuals will be selected more often. Let's go back to this mathematical description. Individuals are assigned fields on the roulette wheel, the size of which is proportional to their fitness. Then the roulette wheel is spun pop size times, selecting the drawn individual for the new population. We know this already. The same principle is implemented by the stochastic universal sampling method, which provides better properties of randomness during selection and is also more efficient than this naive implementation that you could think about. So you can read this footnote, which leads to Wikipedia page stochastic universal sampling. Okay? So this is quite a nice and simple method. It only suffers from one drawback, which is it is too random, which means it may be too unfair, because sometimes you may have, like here, 2 good individuals, but this method does not guarantee that the ball will ever drop into any of those 2 slots. Okay? We may be unlucky and we may select, for example, 4 times the worst individual. Of course, it's unlikely, but sometimes it will happen. This is guaranteed to sometimes happen because it's probabilistic. And then we could be maybe unhappy with the outcome, because this way we will lose those 3 quite good individuals. And it is not what we wanted to have in optimization, right? We spent some time, our CPU used some energy to work for some time, and then we lose what we earlier discovered. It will happen rarely, but it will happen. So this is what we don't like about this roulette wheel method. Otherwise, on average, it's quite okay. Stochastic remainder selection without replacement. Each individual gets as many copies in the new population as the integer part of its EI. So now we would have to calculate this EI, this expected number of copies in the new population. The remaining three places are filled by randomly deciding for each individual, with the probability being the fractional part of its EI, whether it should go to the new population. Example, four individuals and fitness function values are given here. Sounds complicated, but maybe try it by yourself based on this description. It's not so difficult as it may seem. We need to calculate EI for each of these four individuals. Remember that population size is 4 in this case. Okay? So try to go through this example, calculate 4 times EI, and then imagine how this method is better from this pure roulette wheel selection, and whether it will somehow restrict this randomness, this pure randomness of this fitness proportionate random selection with replacement, which is the roulette wheel method. Let's pause. You need to calculate EI first, and first you will also need to calculate the sum of all fitnesses. So the sum of all fitnesses is 15. And then we calculate this normalized fitness quality, fitness value. So it would be 1/15, 3/15, 5/15, and 6/15. And then you need to multiply it by population size, which is 4. So then it would be 4/15, 12/15, 20/15, and 24/15. And then you need to calculate the integer part of this. So we had here, I guess, 4/15 and 12/15. So the integer part is 0, 0. Here we have 20/15, and 20/15 is 1 5/15. So the integer part is 1. And here we have 24/15. So again, the integer part is 1. Okay? So those two individuals, which are the best ones, will get 1 copy in the new population guaranteed. And we still have 2 free places in the new population. And then we may use some random or more random in its nature method of selection, like, for example, this roulette wheel or some other. Okay? But we limited this pure randomness of the roulette wheel. And this way, we are protected against, for example, losing those best guys. Unless they are not so much different in their quality. And then we could have, for example, 0 as the integer part of every solution. And the method would be random, but at the same time, since there would be no disproportions in the quality of solutions, we wouldn't be worried so much about losing the better solutions that we earlier discovered. Selection according to random tournaments. K individuals are randomly drawn, and then the winner, the individual with the highest fitness, is placed in the new population. The process is repeated until all places are filled in the new population. A more careful variant of this technique ensures that each individual participates in the same number of tournaments. This is a very simple technique, and I would encourage you to use it always as the first choice. So if you don't want to make things complicated, if you don't know anything specific about your optimization problem, you should start with tournament selection. And it's so simple to implement. You have a population of individuals, let's say 100 individuals. The only thing you need to decide is the size of the tournament. Let's say that you pick number 3. The size of the tournament is 3. So if you want to select for the new population, let's say you have 100 individuals and you need to have 100 new individuals, you need to repeat this selection process 100 times. And for each selection, you select three individuals completely at random. Remember three because you decided that the tournament size is three. And then you pick the best out of the three. And this way you select one guy. And then you repeat it again and again and again and again 100 times. And if you only want to select one individual, you repeat this process once. You just randomly select three individuals and pick the best one. Okay? It's so simple. Of course, you may ask, how should I adjust this size of the tournament? Because it has some important influence on the behavior of this selection process. So think about what is the influence of the size of the tournament. What happens if you have a very low number as the size of the tournament, so a small tournament, and what happens when you have a big tournament? What will happen to the optimization, evolutionary optimization algorithm? Let's pause. Obviously, the size of the tournament is exactly this selective pressure. So the higher the size of the tournament, the more probable it is that you will be selecting and making more and more copies of good individuals as compared to those poor individuals. So you will be losing diversity, but you have to be careful because if you have a huge population, like 10,000 individuals, and your tournament size is very low, very small, like for example two individuals only, then your selective pressure will be very low, and we have just discussed the consequences of having too high and too low selective pressure. So probably the size of the tournament should be somehow related or somehow dependent on the size of the population. Maybe like a square root or some function like this. Other selection techniques. Deterministic remainder-based selection. Each individual gets as many copies in the new population as the integer part of its EI. So it's exactly as with this approach. And the remaining free places in the population are filled in order of decreasing fractional parts of individual EI. So this is the selection method where we never actually use the random function. It's completely deterministic, and we have some footnote here. Here, discussion about types of non-determinism and the role of non-determinism in algorithms and computer science, an example, and so on. I will skip this for now, assuming that you are during your first year and first semester of studying artificial intelligence, so we are not ready yet for this discussion. You would need to know a lot other algorithms and have some experience in programming and some intuition, some computer science intuition to discuss this in a meaningful way. But you remember what I said earlier, that this pure randomness, like we saw in this roulette wheel selection, is not always so good. So here in this second method, we restricted this pure randomness a little bit. We left some randomness, but we control it in a way. And in this method, we actually got rid of randomness entirely. And this method is entirely deterministic. Will it work? Yes, it will work. So it's not a big loss. On the other hand, there are some dangers in deterministic methods, but as I mentioned, maybe we will discuss it sometime later. Stochastic remainder selection with replacement. Each individual gets as many copies in the new population as the integer part of its expected number of copies. Okay. The remaining places are filled according to the roulette principle proportionally to the fractional part of EI. Okay, so it's a variation of this. I even mentioned that we could use roulette instead of the method that is described here. So, not a big difference. Ordinal selection. Individuals are assigned integer ranks that correspond to their position in ranking from best to worst. So how it works? We have our original evaluations of each individual and we forget about them. We only build a ranking So the best guy, for example, its fitness value was 3, it gets rank 1. The second best guy, let's assume that its fitness value was 2.5, gets rank 2. The third best guy gets ranked 3, and so on and so on and so on and so on. So we completely forget in this approach about original fitness values, and we only think about this rank position in ranking. The selection is based on the probability function that depends not on raw fitness values, these original fitness values, but on individual positions in the ranking. So we have this ranking, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on, and we build some function on this ranking. So this rank becomes the argument to the function. Like, for example, we order our solutions from best to worst, from rank 1 to rank population size, and we build some function, probably some nonlinear function, which will give the highest value to this first in rank, the best individual, and the lowest value to this worst individual, with rank equal to population size. So we forget about the original function, we build a ranking, and then we build a new function. So first we forget about this continuous value, we have an integer ranking, and then we restore this continuity, but this time we build our own fitness, so to say, fitness or probability function of being selected. Various probability functions are used, linear and non-linear, and the parameters of these functions allow one to adjust selective pressure. Yes, very true, because then we can, for example, adjust how this function is tilted, what's the dominance of the best over the average, over the worst individual, and so on and so on. So, quite a legitimate approach to selection. Additional properties in selection. The most important, elitism, or elitist model. This is simply to ensure that the best individual is always safe, is always protected, and will always propagate to the new population, will never be lost. And why it could be lost? Because of some unwanted properties, stochastic properties of those earlier methods, right? Even the tournament method, by the way, which you may think that it is so safe because always the best guy in the tournament wins. Okay, the best guy wins, but we never guarantee that every solution will take part in a tournament, unless we use some additional tricks. And then the best guy in the entire population may even not be allowed to participate in any tournament. And then it will not be propagated, okay? Unless we have this improved tournament implementations. So this elitist approach or elitist property in selection does not change anything if the selection method naturally will propagate this best individual to the next population or will preserve it somehow. But if it happens that at some point in evolution this best individual is lost, then this additional mechanism of elitism will be activated and this best individual will be artificially introduced or preserved in the new population. Crowding factor model. Similar to nature, where species filling the ecological niche must fight for limited resources, in the crowding model, new individuals replace old individuals from the previous population, taking into account their similarities. I.e., new individuals take the place of the old individuals most similar to them. The crowding factor, a parameter, affects the way individuals are replaced. Okay, so this is an advanced selection mechanism which ensures that we not only replace poor individuals with good individuals, but we also observe how they are similar. And this way we are able to preserve some kind of species in our population, like in nature, for example, we have our biological world, and not all creatures compete against other creatures, right? For example, dogs do not compete with mosquitoes. and creatures living underground do not compete with other creatures which occupy a completely different area in the environment. So this approach is an analogy to this natural phenomenon. We do not want all individuals to compete with others, only with similar. And by the way, what this similarity means? It's similarity in the content of the solution. So we are not only looking at fitness, but if a new super individual or super solution is supposed to replace some existing one, it will replace the most similar one in terms of the contents. That's why we somehow preserve those niches or those species in a single population. So if we have our very important plot, it will work like preserving subpopulations or some groups in our single population. And within each group, there will be some pressure to improve. So we will probably be reaching peaks. In this case, we have cost, where we have this best area here. In traditional approach to selection, when we have solutions here, all other solutions will die out because they are simply worse, and selection will promote only this area. Whereas when we have crowding, we have here another local peak, and this crowding will allow those solutions here to survive. They will be protected by this mechanism of replacing only similar ones. So here we will be replacing worse with better in this area, taking into account similarity, and here we will be replacing poor with better, again, taking into account similarity. So these guys will be safe from these guys, because they are not similar in terms of the contents of the solution. So all in all, this approach preserves diversity. Preserves diversity in a population, at the same time, still keeping this progress and ensuring that better solutions are still preferred over poorer solutions. Meta-schemes of selection. In the following selection methods, parts of the population, subpopulations, or sometimes we also say species, can be independently processed. These methods can therefore also act as a distribution and parallelization scheme for evolution. Since we will be processing some parts of the population, of this single huge population, independently, obviously we could do this in different processes or different threads, or even we could process them remotely in some distributed computer system. Okay? The first model, very popular, is called the island model. A population is split into subpopulations in which the chosen selection scheme operates. For example, tournament, roulette, or some other. So we have one huge population. We split it, for example, into 10 subparts. For example, we have 10,000 individuals. We split it into 10 subpopulations, each subpopulation having 1,000 individuals. And then in each subpopulation, in each 1,000 individuals, we have one of those selection methods, any one we choose. For example, tournament. Evolution proceeds on each island independently, so each 1,000 individuals behaves as if evolutionary algorithm was running in this subpopulation, with periodic migration of some genotypes between islands. This model increases exploration capabilities. Exploration meaning we will be discovering more areas in this huge space of solutions. Because of those islands, right? We have a one island here, one island here, one island here, one island somewhere else. Evolution works on each island independently, so it optimizes. We have occasional migrations of individuals between islands, so there is some exchange of information. Without migration, this wouldn't be different from running 10 independent evolutionary algorithms. So this wouldn't be the island model, this would be 10 times or some number of times independent evolutionary algorithms. What makes island model special is exactly those migrations. Why it is so important? Because this ensures that if one island discovered an interesting location, an interesting solution, it will be transmitted to other islands as well. Otherwise, we would be losing time on those other islands, as we would be losing time if we run 10 independent evolutionary algorithms. Okay? This is a good illustration of this island model. We have four islands. Those reddish dots are individuals, and we have evolution or each island independent or almost independent, because those arrows depict those migrations. Okay? And you have to define some topology of connections, like, for example, maybe you do not want, or maybe you do want, each island to communicate with some other island. It may depend, for example, on your CPU architecture or computer network architecture. How do you want to define those connections? Anyway, I think you understand how powerful this island model is. And now, a small modification of this island model. Convection selection. Unlike in the traditional island model, the division into subpopulations follows the similarity of the value of the objective function of solutions. Convection selection improves the A and so on. So what's the difference? The difference is very simple. Whereas in this pure island model, we didn't completely care about how good those solutions are. So each island was kind of uniform due to those migrations. Of course, by uniform, I mean the range of those fitness values was similar as long as those migrations were frequent enough to exchange all the material. Because we know that there is some trade-off of this frequency of migrations and the similarity of genetic material between those populations. If you imagine another extreme, because I mentioned one extreme, no migrations at all, then we simply have independent evolutionary algorithms. But imagine another extreme, continuous migration between all islands. Then it is no different from a single evolutionary algorithm with a single population, right? So you see that we loosen somehow this interaction between islands, and this is the optimal approach. Neither continuous migration nor no migration at all. And now, in convection selection, we only ensure one additional thing, or we introduce one additional constraint, that each island hosts individuals from some range of qualities, some range of fitness function values. So this is this picture and this picture, for example. Let's take this. So we have four islands, four subpopulations, like we had here, but we have an island which is dedicated to the poorest individuals. We have an island dedicated to somehow better individuals. We have an island dedicated to pretty good individuals. And we have an island dedicated to best ones, to champions. So what consequences does this change have? First of all, when we have competition on each island, because each island hosts evolutionary process, then those best guys only compete with other best guys. And it's not so easy to survive among best guys. And those poorest guys only compete with other poorest guys. So you see that this selective pressure is somehow equalized. Because without this mechanism of convection selection, everybody on each island competes with everybody else. For example, if in this island we are lucky enough to produce a very good solution, a champion, all other individuals or poorer individuals will immediately die out, and this best guy will have many children and they will compete against each other, but this diversity will be lost. So this mechanism somehow preserves diversity on a global level, because due to these periodic migrations, we will always ensure this sorting of individuals. For example, if we have the island with champions and we mutate those champions, and of course when we change a solution, it's not guaranteed that a mutated champion will also be a champion. Sometimes this good solution will get broken, some deterioration will be introduced, And then this deteriorated solution would immediately die out on this island. But due to migration, it will migrate to its proper location, where similar solutions to its quality are located. And similarly, if we have a poor population with poor individuals and we are lucky enough for mutation to produce a champion, a very good solution, this champion will be, during the nearest migration period, will be moved to their proper population, or the population with similar quality of other solutions. Okay, and it will compete there. And of course, it will introduce some diversity, probably, to this subpopulation of champions. So this is how the convection selection works. Now you may think what it actually changes in the behavior or in the optimization capability of the entire evolutionary algorithm. What changes? Compare this approach and this approach. I already told you what are the advantages of this approach, more exploration, but what will change here? In optimization, will this work better or worse compared to this free exchange of any individual? Let's think about it for a moment. It's time for a simple demonstration and also explaining why this selection method is called convection. What it is about this convection? So we have this simple animation. It's a simplified animation. We have four islands. The island for the poorest ones, for the slightly better ones, for quite good ones, and for champions. Okay? On each island, we have evolutionary process. That's why we see those moving lines, lines moving upwards. Okay? Sometimes we have migrations. So, for example, if some individual gets broken and its fitness drops, or some new individual is produced with poor fitness, it will drop to the proper subpopulation or to the subpopulation with a proper range of fitness values. No? Like, for example, we saw this drop here. And of course, we assume that since each population struggles due to this evolutionary nature of the process, struggles to produce better and better and better individuals, they will be migrating to higher and higher, better and better subpopulations or better and better islands. Okay, so this is a simplified visualization. Now let's have a look at a real example. Before I show you the animation, I will explain what you see here. This time you see five subpopulations. This is the subpopulation with the worst individuals. This is slightly better, quite good, and champions here. Five subpopulations. Here we have fitness. And each circle is a single individual, whereas those ranges indicated by those dashed lines indicate the range of fitness values existing on each island. So this island, for example, island P1 or subpopulation P1, only hosts individuals with this fitness range. And the second subpopulation hosts individuals in this fitness range. The third in this, the fourth in this, and the subpopulation with champions hosts individuals which share this fitness range. Okay? So nothing new here. Those two progress bars will show progress of the entire evolutionary process and also progress of evolution between migrations. So you will see in a moment those progress bars working, and occasionally during migration you will see the movement of those individuals, those circles, between islands. So horizontal movements. You will see, for example, that when this island, the island with the worst individuals, will produce an exceptionally good individual, it will be migrating to the proper island. So you will see horizontal movement in this direction. Whereas when you see champions being broken, like deteriorating mutations, you will see movements in the left direction, okay? To the proper island, to the island which is dedicated to this fitness range. Let's see how this works. Oh, by the way, when we start, we will start with poorer solutions, and you will see that those solutions move up in time. So this is how it works, okay? This population is unable to produce an... Oh, now it produced something interesting and it was moved to a better subpopulation. So this is how it progresses. Let's skip a number of generations. And this is where it ends, the last generation. And I asked you, what's the difference between this approach, this convection approach, and this pure island model? Whether it is beneficial to introduce this idea or not. So let's think about advantages and disadvantages. There is one clear disadvantage. When we have this approach, we always reserve some islands to host poor individuals. No matter what, we lose some part of our entire population, like you saw on this animation. Some part of the population is dedicated to always keeping worst individuals. Maybe they are not at the later stages of evolution. Maybe they are not so poor like they were initially. But still, you think, why would I want to have a part of our population as the sum of all subpopulations to host always poor individuals? It seems like losing computational power. In traditional approach, since you have those migrations and no restrictions on fitness range, like you have here, those poor individuals would simply die out because they would be dominated by those good individuals. And since what you care in optimization about is efficiency, you would spend your time efficiently. You would spend your time mutating and changing those good individuals and not those bad ones. So the obvious consequence of employing convection selection is that this algorithm is convergent more slowly than the traditional island model without any restrictions. So the convergence rate is slower. At the same time, you have some benefits to keeping those poor individuals, because every time some individual gets broken and falls down here, they have time for evolution to improve it, and it's like going up, but this time different route. So you may reach some different peak, and this is why you introduce diversity. Okay? So in the long term, there may be benefits in that you will discover better or different peaks, different optima, than you discovered in this approach. And this is exactly what happens. Another difference is this preservation of diversity. When you have this architecture, the outcome of the algorithm may look like this. So on the horizontal axis you have time, which means generations. On the vertical axis you have fitness, and each dark dot means that at this point in time, in some population, we had an individual of this fitness value. And you see that this algorithm stagnates. So there is hardly any addition of new ideas or new genetic material when we have this architecture. Whereas when you run the same optimization problem with convection selection, it starts looking like this or like this. Actually, this and this plot are different architectures. The difference is not so big in the concept. Anyway, you immediately see that a lot happens during evolution all the time. So no matter how long you run this algorithm, it will always try to discover new ways of reaching those peaks, new ways of climbing, okay? And you see those convections as well. So you see that from island to island, those individuals are passed up and they evolve on each island, competing with solutions which are similar to them in their quality. And what I said about those advantages and disadvantages, if you have a simple optimization problem, by simple I mean simple fitness landscape, like a smooth fitness landscape. Of course, if it's very simple, you wouldn't even use evolutionary algorithm. You would use either local search or maybe simulated annealing, taboo search, and so on. But if it is slightly more complex, so that using evolutionary algorithms is justified, then if you use a simple single population algorithm, you may converge faster than you would converge if you employed convection selection. But if the problem is very complex, this page is huge and the fitness landscape is rugged, not smooth, then if you run a traditional algorithm, you will converge very fast to some solution and you will stay at this level because the algorithm will be unable to discover other peaks, whereas for convection selection, there is higher probability that in time it will converge slower. Look how quick was this convergence here. At this point, we are basically stuck at this optimum, whereas here at this point, we were still exploring and we are exploring and exploring and exploring, and ultimately you may reach a better optimum. And even here you see some tiny improvement. Also here probably there are some tiny improvements. Of course, there is always a chance that this traditional algorithm will also improve over time, even over a long time, but this probability is much, much, much lower than when you employ this convection idea. So there you have it. I explained selection techniques in quite a detail, so that you understand how it works. I think now, especially when we talked about this island model and I showed you how it works, you understand better what could happen in the population and what are our goals, what we want and we don't want from evolutionary optimization. The selection techniques mentioned above have their pros and cons. In particular, the first of them, the roulette method, has a high variance that results in large differences between the actually achieved and the expected number of individuals. So we expect good individuals to dominate poor individuals, but due to the randomness of the roulette method, it is not always guaranteed. We talked about this randomness and that we would want to somehow restrict this randomness a little bit. Hence, many techniques were introduced, such as stochastic remained selection without replacement, that overcome this drawback. The choice of the selection method has a big impact on the behavior of the algorithm, in particular on the ability to cross saddles during optimization. Saddles are what you could expect them to be. You can read the Wikipedia page about it. Sometimes, depending on the adapted GA architecture, in addition to using a positive selection, it is also necessary to employ a negative selection. I told you that sometimes we need to make free plays to new individuals and we need to decide whom to kill, unfortunately. Its role is to make room in the population for new genotypes. Negative selection decides which genotypes to remove from the population. And by the way, I told you about this generational replacement architecture and steady state. And I told you that in steady state, when we included a new individual in the population, we needed to decide whom to kill or whom to remove. And this was this negative selection. And you could think that in generational architecture, negative selection is not needed. And we never decide whom to remove. And you may be right, but not entirely, because in a generational approach, when we simply generate a new population and a new population and a new population, you do not explicitly need negative selection, but at the same time, you forget about the entire previous population all the time in every generation. And this means that those guys who were not selected to the new population are simply lost. So it's like an implicit negative selection. Everybody dies who was not chosen, not selected to the new population. So it's a hidden negative selection. Similar mechanisms as for the positive selection can be used. Two examples of naive methods are deleting the worst genotype and a random one. So this is related to these negative selection techniques. So you could use all the techniques that we learned when we thought about positive selection, but you can employ them in reverse. Enumerate and summarize the selection techniques you learned. What are the disadvantages and advantages of each technique? Two sample questions, but as usual, you can come up with your own verifying questions to test your knowledge. During the next presentation, I will talk about crossing over and mutation. So see you then.